London, 1875. The Cabinet of Gadgetry, or COG for short, was interested in creating Her Majesty's transportation apparatus. You will be one of those inventors attempting to help create this apparatus. And if you are the best inventor by creating the most of the gadgetry for the apparatus to ferry Her Majesty's citizens across the town, then you will be successfully labeled as the Grand Inventor and you will successfully win the game COG. COG plays 2 to 4 players, is by Dr. Finn Games, and takes roughly 45 minutes. And in the game, you will be gathering different gadgetry. You're also going to be utilizing cards to take activations, and you're going to be placing down letters to make words. Those words will let you gather gadgets, which will in turn let you make the apparatus. The first player to, have the most points at the end of the 6th or 7th round, depending on the number of players, will be the winner of COG. Let's go and take a look down below. I'll show you what the game comes with and how to play, and then we'll discuss it, and we'll see. Maybe we'll get somebody to talk about it with us as well. This is a 2-player setup for the game COG. Now, of course, it plays 3 and 4 players, and if you want to, you can add this extra board here, or boards, as well as turn this over to the 4-player side and play with it as is. But we're going to just go ahead and show you 2 players. And to do that, all you're going to do is you're going to give every single player a player board. You're going to give players a card for their turn order, a certain number of COGs, 4 to be exact, and then these word cubes, which you'll use whenever you make words on this board. You'll place these cubes in here to signify that you've made or built those words. Additionally, you're going to have currency or victory points, which you'll set aside so players can gather them as they earn them. Additional star power, which you will gain to get specific bonus abilities or turning these specific tiles into wilds. And then the main board. The main board works like this. Depending on the number of players, you're going to set up the board on each, the left, right, and top and bottom of the board. Now, playing a 2-player game, so we're just going to use these 2 die. If we're playing 3, we'd add a blue one. And if we're playing 4, we would add a black die. On this side here, we're playing 2 players, so we only need the 1st and 2nd space, and it tells you on the 2nd space you put a star here, and on the 3rd it tells you you put 3 victory points here, and the 1st place you get nothing, because this is all about turn order. Down here are the COG cards, and based on the number of players, how many cards will come down, and in this case it's going to be 2, and in a 3-player it will be 3, and then 4 will be 4. Finally, up here is the same thing. We're going to be getting letters from the bag here, and these symbols are equating to letters. This symbol here is equating to a star. So place 2 letters from the bag here, 1 letter here, and 1 star here. If you were playing with 3 players, you would go ahead and place 2 here and 1 star. And that's pretty much the setup for that. Additionally, you're going to go ahead and place 3 letters from the bag here. And then for each player in the game, go ahead and take their pawn and place them on the starting space, which is the green little square here. Last thing, the clock. The clock will determine the number of rounds in the game, and it will progress as the rounds go on. And in a for a 2 or 3 player game, it will be 6 rounds, and in the 7th, or sorry, vice versa. In a 2 or 3 player game, it'll be 7 rounds, and in a 4-player game, it'll be 6 rounds, thusly reducing the amount of time it takes to play the game. So that is basically the prep phase. You're going to be prepping each of the sides of the board here, as well as placing these in the middle here, and then you're going to move on to the next phase of the game. The last thing I didn't tell you is that there are 6 of these different types here, but they are all the same. At the beginning, you're going to roll a die, and based on that number, you remove that specific number away from every single player. So in this case, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, which means that we rolled 6 and we got rid of the 6th one. So there are extra ones for each player, and that changes the game up just a little bit. So collecting, how does that work? Well, we're going to be utilizing these 4 cogs, and each of these cogs is going to go either in the top, bottom, left, or right positions of the board, and you can't have more than 1 in each of the said positions. And players are going to take turns in order placing cogs down, something like this. 1 here, 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 1 here. And that's all the collect phase is. But as you place these things down, you're going to take the actions provided in the spaces. So, for instance, if you place your cogs in these positions here, you can either take 1st player next turn or 2nd player next turn. And if you choose to take 2nd player, you'll get this little star token. And star tokens are wild and provide unique bonus effects, which I'll talk about later. On this side here are die, And if you place your cogs in these positions, you'll take the associated die along with the number of pips, and you will move your character on this track in a clockwise fashion and gain whatever bonus is provided on the space that you land on. So for instance, if I were to take this 4 here, I could then move my pawn 4 spaces, and I would take whatever bonus it is, which in this case is 1 letter. I would take this and put it on my board. The same would be said for yellow, in which case I'd go ahead and move 2, and I would take a star from the supply pool over here. Down here, you're going to be using cards or taking cards. When you place one of your cogs in the space, you'll take this card or this card and place it over here, which you will then be able to use to activate, provided you have the requirements on your turn in the next phase, which is going to be the activate phase. Some of them are going to be things that will allow you to build additional words, and others will give you a specific benefit that will either be used every turn, once a turn, or forever in any amount that you would wish. That, and finally the top section over here. When you place a cog in either of these areas here, you'll gather whatever resources that are provided. So for instance, placing a cog up here is going to give you a T and an O. Placing a cog over here will give you a star and an R. Now, stars are interesting because they give you special powers. The first special power it gives you on this side of the board is if I have a star and I don't like the position I'm in, I can spend a star to switch positions with another player. Over here, I can place my cog down, I can spend a star, and I can re-roll this die, which will let me move my character in a different way, as well as some of the cards here will basically tell you you have to use certain die in order to activate them, like this one requires the yellow die, and this one requires the pink die, and some of them will actually require you to have a certain number of pips, so re-rolling this die will help. Another thing with this board here is you can't move onto the same space as another player. So if both of these were 4 and the first player took the action here and moved 4 spaces, the next player would not be able to go onto that space, in which case rerolling the die is definitely going to be of benefit for you. And finally, using a star on one of these cards here lets you discard the card you drew and take a new card, which will be useful, especially if you can't use this card or it's not as beneficial as maybe something else in the deck. After you've taken all those actions, if you've basically run out of all these cogs here, you'll move on to the activate phase. Now, activating is only going to be useful if you have these cards here, and you're only going to be activating these type of cards. This one specifically says, for infinity, it doesn't require any die, and you can flip over an H, a P, and a K at any point in time to make them wild. Wilds are simply letters of any type and will let you build any type of word. Very, very nice to have something like this, but this is forever activated, whereas some other cards, like this one here, says you can activate it once around during the activation phase. As long as you have a 1 or a 2 pipped die, you will gain 1 victory point and draw a tile from the bag here. So that's when you're going to be activating everything, and players will do that as well simultaneously. Next, you'll go into the construction phase, which everybody will simultaneously be placing letters to build words, either horizontally or vertically, and they'll have to start in these positions here. Whenever they cross these specific bonus areas here, they'll gain a bonus. For instance, they'll gain 1 of the letters from the bag, or if they hit the ends over here, they'll gain 10 victory points, or they're going to gain 2 stars and a letter from the bag, or even a cog card, which will let you hopefully activate something very nice. And players have to build words in this phase in order to do so. Stars are also beneficial here because if you spend a star, you can flip these over and make them wilds to use to build words. Now, the only words you want to build are going to be the ones associated on these cards here. And when you build a word, you will take this little cube and place it in the area. So if I actually built the word pulley here, I would take the cube and place it here. If you build all of the words on a specific card, you're going to gain the victory points as well as any bonuses, and then you're going to go ahead and flip that over, signifying that you have done that card. It's very unlikely you'll build all 5 of these, but that's okay. It's a good way to gain a lot of victory points throughout the game. Finally, you're then going to conclude. You're going to advance the game clock 1 space. If it is at the final space, that will end the game. You're also then going to distribute turn order cards based on players who place their cogs here, so these might switch in a 2-player game. You're then going to retrieve any cogs that were on the board. You're going to return the die back to the pool here. You're going to take a letter if you have 2 or less in this area here. Or you're going to check your max, and you're going to check your maximums. You can only have 7 letters, and you're only allowed to have 3 stars at the end of a turn. So make sure that you spend them if you can. After that, you'll continue playing up until the point in which you get to the 6th or 7th turn, to which you'll start scoring, and you'll check all your bonus victory conditions. You're also going to check your big stack of points that you're getting throughout the game, and whoever has the most is the winner of the game cogs. So go ahead and enjoy building tons of different words, taking action placement, or worker placement, and satisfying a bunch of different crazy conditions throughout the game as you try and successfully fill your Majesty's order. Let's come up and discuss the game. Alright, so I got Callie here, and that's a good thing. Hello. Because I have a caveat, and she can explain it because I goofed, apparently.
Just one small thing. When you're using the dice to move along the track here, when you get to the tile that has the plus symbols on it, you're going to take one tile, and it's actually going to be from one of these spaces in the middle. Or, if you get the double one, you'll take two. Or the tile and the star. So, not from the bag, it's from the board.
And when you go into the prepare phase, which is the first phase of the game, you'll be placing down new tiles from the bag into the middle location. So it gives you more choice as to what letters you want when walking across this board here. So I think that's pretty much it. There's also, of course, two sides to this.
When if a second player gets the same number and would go on the same space, they can actually go on that space.
Oh, they get nothing.
But they get nothing.
Yeah.
So usually you want to avoid that, which is why you would want to reroll. But you can, if you have to, just go on that space and take the loss.
Oh, she got so grumbly when she had to go on that space, too.
Yeah, it feels like, because it's a lot. The resources are really important for getting those letters.
So let's go over the game. We'll start with the quality of the components. I think it's excellent.
Yes. I really like the word tiles. You know, putting the little tokens in there feels so satisfying.
They're thick. They're high
They're
quality.
Really thick.
All of the pieces are very nice. Standard pieces like the die, but they are nice. Even the different coloration of the die, they're unique to this specific game. I haven't seen any colors like these.
Yeah.
And they're easy to tell the difference between, so I think colorblind people will be able to deduce that fairly easily. The star tokens are really cool as well. They provide a lot of variety in the game. You're able to utilize them as far as the tiles go, as far as each of the different sections of the board go, in a way that can help you either gain the momentum by going first, or being able to reroll the die if you don't want to get stuck with having to go to the same space as somebody else.
It gives you a lot of options for how you want to play the game and developing your strategy.
Now, also, there are, like I said before, six of these tiles, which she was talking about specifically, that will allow you to create 3 to 4 words, maybe even 2 words, and then you're going to get victory points for them. In every game, you're going to roll the die to start, which will determine what one you are not using, which will change the game to a certain extent. One thing I can say about the game specifically is you have to build specific words. You can't simply build whatever words you want. And I think that would be a nice maybe addition or expansion at some point where you can actually start creating your own words. Tiles that will have a wild, it says, oh, maybe a five letter word of any type, or a 7 letter word of any type, something like that. So you can kind of do a little more creative word design, because the game does feel a little bit like, I want to say Scrabble, but is that the word? Yeah,
yes.
It is Scrabble,
yes.
Right? Now, it's obviously not Scrabble.
Yeah.
It feels a little bit like it in certain ways because you are building, but a lot of it has to do with your worker placement and where you choose to place certain things.
And it's, yeah, just a small part of the game is building those words, because you can also use the cards to build the words as well and place them on your word list. And actually, as well, we didn't even get to it till the end of the game, where we figured out these are actually, whoever has the most of these also gets additional victory points.
There are definitely a lot of extra victory points, which I guess you can go ahead and read them yourself. But it's nice to know how many you get. For any incomplete goal tiles you don't finish, you'll get points for. Completed item cards, as well as every letter tiles as well, you're going to score extra points for. So even if you don't get all of the words down, you can still win the game by gathering a lot of these cog cards, which I'm probably wrong about what they're called. I keep calling them that, but they're going to be called cabinet cards.
Yeah.
And if you can get a whole bunch of these, you can win the game with this as well.
Well, I think that's what pushed you over the edge in our game.
I thought I was going to lose, but upon not reading the extra victory elements, it ended up pushing me ahead. The quality of the game, like I said before, is great, and also the thematic element is presented very nicely as well. You're going to be able to build these specific words that function in relation to steampunk theme, in which you're trying to make this contraption for her Majesty. I mean, I wouldn't say it's fully themed outright. Like, it, obviously you're trying to build these cards, which makes contraptions, which gives you that vehicle, but it's not inherent, unless you read, obviously, the flavor text, which then you get that idea of being in this world of building things.
But you're building things, you're puzzling. What's the best way to use to get all these resources and put them in the way that's going to make sense to build the most things?
And construction does come out in the game. Like, you do feel the theme of construction, and the word design is a nice, clever way of making something that's more of a classic feel to something that's much more modern. I really enjoyed this game. My only one nitpick, obviously, is I want to be able to build my own words. And as we're doing that, we just can't. You have to build the words that are provided with you, and you're always like, I don't want to make the word oil. I want to make the word tangerine. Okay, you probably can't do that. Oh, and if you do not build well your words down in the area provided, you can get stuck. You have to use a lot of wilds.
Yeah, there are some placement rules. Can't build the letters different words like right next to each other. You have to space them out. So, like, I waited and built a longer word first, so I would have a little bit more mobility in that way.
Yeah, she's better at making words. And I had too many small ones, which is fine, except for the fact that I actually have to start making a bunch of wilds. And wilds cost star power, which then I can't utilize for the board. And so it comes to this toss-up. But you don't need to build all of the different word cards to win the game. You can kind of situate yourself in any way you want to win the game, utilizing the cabinet cards or even just moving around the board in the middle. That can score you points as well as gain you some unique aspects to the game. Overall, it's a very satisfying game. I really enjoyed it. It's probably not my favorite game from Dr. Finn, because they have a lot of great games like Herbaceous and... well, they have a lot. You can go ahead and look them up just on my channel alone. But I did really like this one. I'm not a big word puzzly dude. I'm not very good at these type of games, which is probably why I was just like, words and having to organize things.
But it's not... You don't have to, like, have a great vocabulary or anything to play this game.
Which is also positive for me, but maybe not so much for her. Because she likes that. For me, it was nice. This is what I need to do. These are what I need to get. Can I get them? Can I place them in the right order in order to score me the most points for the game cog? Mm-hmm. Pretty solid. I enjoyed it overall. And I think if you are interested, based on how we explained it and what we described, I think you should check it out.
Yep. What do you think? If you like the puzzly kind of thinking, worker placement, and figuring out how you're gonna do stuff and getting better with it over time, it's a great one to pick up.
And of course, like I said, there's 3- and 4-player game as well, and you'll use the board. You can actually go ahead and flip it over, and it'll provide more stuff. It'll show you all the different things you can add to the game when you're playing additional players, additional letters we're going to be utilizing, and it doesn't play any differently in a negative or positive way. It plays pretty simply the same way a worker placement would be, with spots filling up, and you may or may not get the best things you want, but it does present a nice aspect to turn order and making that much more important to maybe a 2-player game. Obviously, you're going to want to utilize the turn order a lot more and pushing players back and forth. There's definitely more benefit to stars on certain sides of the board depending on the number of players in the game. That's it. That's what I got for you. Thanks for coming on and talking about the game COG by Dr. Finn Games. And if you're interested, go ahead and check out the link down below, where you can go ahead and pick up the game yourself. All right, guys. Thank you so much for watching. And as always, I look forward to...
see you guys next time.
Yeah, that's the one.